hot take, new Games Workshop plastics are way better than the old metal models. Just look at them. Saint Celestine, total glow up. Nagash, way better. Necron Overlord, it's unreal. Gene Sealer Cult Magus, Hey guys, Jay here. Welcome to Eons of Battle. I know it might not be a popular opinion, but if there's ever been a golden age of Games Workshop miniatures, I think we must be living in it. New plastic seemingly every week, mostly hits, very rarely misses, but at the end of the day, I just want cool stuff. And new does not necessarily mean better. Although it usually does. Search your feelings, you know it to be true. 3D digital sculpting has led to amazing improvements in model design. It's just such a powerful tool. And I know from experience. I have done some digital sculpting, I've used programs like AutoCAD, Vectorworks, SketchUp, Rhinoceros, and Blender, and it is amazing. I have spent hours with these programs and the ability to quickly design things iteratively with tools like Undo, flying cameras, and Boolean operations just makes for amazing results. That would be nearly impossible to do with hand sculpting. Now, a common complaint I hear about digital designs is it doesn't take a lot of skill, it's just copying and pasting. But that is not true at all. It all uses the same skills, it's just using different tools. Digital tools don't mean they require less skill, it just means that the artist can get more granular and can get into the fine-tuning of their creation faster. Another common complaint I see is that digitally designed models lack soul. They don't have that special something, but that is absolutely not true. Hand sculpting is not synonymous with good models. Think about it. Think of some of the models that have come and gone over the years. Sculpted models are just like hand sculpted models. They can be awesome and amazing, and they can be boring and lame. It all depends. What got me thinking about this old versus new debate was this guy I found on eBay. It just so happens that I have the perfect example of both old school 40k and modern 40k. This is a Gene Sealer Cult Magus, and I think it is the perfect example of a great old model and a new model that might not be an upgrade. I think there is a lot to appreciate about both, and I think that there's a lot of discoveries to be made during painting. My modern one is already done and I have those experiences, so now it's time to make some new experiences with this old guy. It's time to paint. Now this is a retro model and it'll require a retro paint job, so I'm gonna need to gather paints and supplies like it's 1989. Bright paint colors, no subtlety allowed. Sand of one uniform grain size that's too big. One large paintbrush, no Da Vinci Maestros for this project. A slotted 25mm base. And of course, for the base, some good old-fashioned goblin green. I'm just kidding. I want this to look good. The new Cult Magus is fun, but there's something about this old fella. It's like the story of an evil magician is told better with a simpler sculpt. I'm painting this guy up to go in my modern Gene Sealer Cult army, and like most models this old, it is way, way too short. So I'm gonna be putting him on a little bit of a cork tower. But first, I gotta get rid of this pesky tab. I took my nippers and made two cuts and removed the center of the tab, leaving two little nubbies on the ends. Then I took a steel file and shaped those nubbins into round pegs, much easier and faster than drilling and pinning. Look at them nubbies. I used to always chop off the peg, but this works much better. I find it very helpful to have two pairs of nippers, and these are both cheapy cheap nippers. I don't think you should spend a lot of money on these because they do dull and wear out over time. But right now this is my good pair that has nice sharp new blades, and this is my old one. And this is what I use on metal, wood, whatever I need to cut through, but might damage them. I just use my old pair of nippers. And then I keep this for cutting out all of my new models. But one day, this will become my bad pair, and this will become my garbage pair. Now it was time for cork. I held my base up to the sheet to see how much I would need, and then I began tearing it up. Then I super glued it down, putting glue on both halves. I made sure the cork was smaller than the rim of the base, and that the top tier was smaller than the previous one. I did some further pruning when it was all dry to get it to the exact shape I wanted. Now my nubbins are a little delicate, so I don't want to just stab them into the cork. I took some blue paint and dipped the pegs into the paints to make myself some marks on the cork. Then I drilled holes and it fit perfectly. And I glued him down using copious amounts of super glue. Whenever you're working with cork, make sure to not skimp on the super glue. Use way too much, more than you'll think you'll need. If you have time to let things dry, E600 glue or Gorilla Glue would probably make a better choice. But for a little project like this, super glue is gonna work just fine. It was time for the sand. I poured myself some wood glue, my preferred sand sticking glue, and began spreading this onto the base. I kept it mostly to the exposed base. I put a little on the cork, but I mostly left it all natural. I want that cork for its real texture. Then I gave it my usual sand routine, a sprinkling of some small pebbles, then a light drizzle of some medium grit sand, and then lastly filling in the rest with some fine grain sand. There, now he's an appropriate height for wargaming in 2021. I stuck him down to a paint handle and it was time to paint. I'm gonna try to modern this guy up with a paint job, and so I'm gonna be giving it a good old fashioned Zenithal Prime. And I think I've finally gotten to the bottom of this, because I have always struggled with doing a proper Zenithal highlight. I use the classic Liquitec Titanium White, but forever I've been getting spattery, speckly finishes and I've not been too happy with it. But I've gotten to the bottom of it. Usually with inks, I don't thin it down at all. It just runs beautifully through the airbrush. But with white, you have to thin it a lot. Now I put in lots of thinner and I get buttery Zenithal highlights. I also have to apply many, many coats, like 4 or 5, but that's how you get a really good Zenithal highlight. A quick black prime for my favorite airbrush primer, Steinel Res Black Primer. Then it was time for the good stuff, a blast from above with my thinned titanium white, and I got a gorgeous Zenithal. I hope I can make my paint job look just as good as this Zenithal highlight. I can't put it off any longer. It's time to put paint onto the model. I started off with a watery dark red, and I put this all over his cloak. This is just an even coat to tint it all red. The Zenithal poking through shows me where I should apply my dark reds and my light reds next. I find red a really easy color to work with, and I actually really like the Games Workshop paint Corn Red and Evil Sun Scarlet. I have not found red that I like more than these colors. This model had really exaggerated wrinkles and folds in his robe, and it took to highlighting really well. In no time at all, the cloak was done, and now it's time to paint his weapons. Next up is painting the gold, and I've had a little bit of a breakthrough with my painting of gold. I used a base coat with Vallejo Earth, it's kind of a light brown color, and this worked, but the problem with this is it didn't give a lot of contrast because this is basically the same value that the paint ends up at. Now I base coat with a dark brown, and this gives me much better contrast to my gold. This color basically becomes my shadows, and I really like how it looks. I base coated his staff with dark brown, and threw this onto his last pistol holster as well, and his little booty sticking out of his robe. Then I did a dry brushing of some gold paint. I'm using my Army Painter dry brush that has a small chisel-shaped bristles. This will keep the paint only where I want it to be. Then a nice wash with good old-fashioned Agrax Earthshade. Then another lighter dry brushing of gold and some bright silver paint. This is representing the light reflecting off the gold. Then I took some black paint and threw this onto his cowl. Some nice darker color here will really make his bald cultist head pop. And I threw some Nuln Oil Wash over the white parts of his priestly armor. This helped to push the shadows that were already present from my Zenithal. After that, I did a dry brushing of white to bring up the color of his armor. I want this to be the brightest white I can so that it really stands out on the tabletop. Once the dry brushing was done, I went in with a proper brush and just made sure that the areas I wanted 100% white were fully painted. I was surprised to see on this guy, he has little tiny vials of poison. I assume it's poison, and I was actually really surprised to see this detail because on all of my modern gene stealers, you see those little vials here and there, and I always just assume that it's like another superfluous detail Games Workshop threw in there to fill up space in the model. But no, as it turns out, little tiny vials are actually an OG gene stealer decoration, and they're really hard to paint. To paint these tiny, tiny vials, I started with a black base coat, then a stripe of blue-black to make these look more like small glass vials, then a smaller stripe of dark green to represent the liquid held in the vials. This strip is only covering about 50% of the tube. After that, a tiny dot of green, so the color is more visible. And now it's time for the real business. A microscopic stripe of bright green. This is representing the top of the liquid reflecting light. I also threw the smallest dot you have ever seen of this bright green onto the bottom of each vial. And speaking of vials of poison, you know what is never poisonous? That's right, the Eons of Battle Patreon. If you enjoy the videos we make, you might consider becoming a member. Over there, you'll gain access to some behind the scenes, voting on what models I paint live here on YouTube, a live hobby hangout every week, and more. With that said, let's finish up with this green paint. While I had green on my brush, I also threw this onto the gems. Some dark green for a base coat, a highlight on the top half of true green, then lastly some reflections or edge highlights of bright green. And finally, a tiny reflection dot of white paint on the left-hand side of the gem. This helped them look shiny, and if you wanted to push it even further, a little gloss paint would also look good. I'm almost done with this guy. These old models like this paint up really quick because there's just not that many details. And now it's time to finish him up with his skin. Now for my Jean Sealer Cult, I do something kind of special for the skin. I use four colors, and two of them make perfect sense. A beige red and a light pink tan. But the other two colors are dark brown and magenta. Here's how I do it. I started his head with a nice watery base coat of beige red, using thin paint to take advantage of my Zenithal. Then I watered down some dark brown and glazed this all over his flesh. This is a little like a wash, but it'll tint the colors more. I did the same exact thing with my magenta. This will give him a little bit of color. Then I brought back the beige red and cleaned it up a little bit, making sure that all of his details were present. And then I brightened it up with a little light pink tan. This strat I have works wonders on super detailed modern models. But on this guy's old, flat, hand-sculpted face, it needed a lot more touch-ups. And I had to freehand his alien forehead ridges. I used Commander Worf as inspiration. Then for his eyes, there was not much there. I painted the general eye area black. After that, I went in with white, and there was only two very tiny dots that I could paint white. Not a lot of room for error. Then finally, a nerve-wracking black pupil. This took many tries to get right. Lastly, the base. A nice base coat of Vallejo Earth, a go-to color for painting, you guessed it, Earth. Then a dry brushing of some tan paint. This is all in preparation for a big old dusting of some brown weathering pigments. Then I broke from the norm and painted the base rim brown. I do this to all my cultists. He was done at this point, but I wanted to apply some tufts. I picked one out, but I felt it was way too big. I cut it into many smaller pieces, and this one tuft ended up making seven. I gave the base a really nice sprinkling of them. It makes the base feel much more realistic. Once I had all these tufts down, the model was finished. While painting this guy up, I went through a lot of flip-flopping. I had this whole idea in my head that this model was an example of how older models can be superior to new ones. But having experienced painting both of these, my opinions have changed, for both models, a little bit. I never loved this plastic Magus, but having painted the old one, I think I have found a new appreciation for him. His details are really nice, and his skin painted up really nice with minimal effort. Meanwhile, I fell in love when I saw this old pewter model, but having painted him, he's just alright. He has a great attitude, and I like his space backpack, but both models have their pros and cons. I feel like this old school pewter mini is more massable than the new one. His more neutral pose would lead to some simple color swaps, and a group of these guys would look pretty good together. The new model has a much more unique and dynamic pose, but if I do the same Photoshop alterations, it just looks silly. It looks like they're a dance troupe. So, does this matter? Probably not. How many Maguses does one need? One is enough, two is plenty, and Games Workshop was nice enough to provide us a third option, the new Lady Magus, which is awesome. Maybe this is the way to have our cake and eat it too, a variety of options. I feel like this is a debate between what is versus what oughta. This guy's dynamic pose is super cool, it makes my imagination and creativity go wild, and it's super inspiring. But logically, this guy's more neutral pose looks better en masse. But it's not really a logic question, it's a game and I just want the coolest models. And now I have three super cool models for my collection. So what do you guys think? Old versus new, is it a debate? It's not like old models are gonna come back. But it's also not like every new model is a 100% upgrade. Maybe we should just get the models we want and avoid the ones we don't. But now it's time for the real star of the show, this week's EOB Complete Submissions. We put out a challenge to our community to send us before and after photos of their recently finished models to be immortalized in our videos. If you want to join in the fun, you can submit a before and after photo of your painted mini to our Discord server, which you can find in the description below, or you can post it to Instagram with the hashtag EOBComplete. Without further ado, let's look at and get inspired by what the folks have finished this week. A Super Cool Gundam by I Sip Potassium Hydroxide. A Chaos Sorcerer by Darth Jig. A Heavy Artillery Piece by The Fry 76. Some Necron Scarab Swarms by Not Mike. Some Imperial Guard Heavy Weapon Teams by Just Make Stuff. A Stormcast Eternal by Benj7730. Some Sci-Fi Troopers by Emil33. A Big Space Marine by Wolfstring. A Necron Army by The Steak Sauce. Some Custom Space Soldiers by TNTGaming285. A Space Marine Whirlwind by Unity. A Gene Stealer Cult Locus by SquidCultist002. A Terminator with Thunderhammer and Storm Shield by Chaplain Brother Nutch. A Custom Necron Cryptek by Digidueler. A Knob on Smash a Squig by Big LEZ. An Imperial Guard Astropath by Sexy Kaya. A Custom Thunder Warrior by Hawkeye20. Some Space Marine Eradicators by Lenk. Some Iron Warrior Space Marines by Heathen Minis. A Bunch of Tau by Owo Main, a Primaris Lieutenant by Dexstar, and a Star Wars Legion Scout Trooper by The Happy Heretic. Congratulations to everyone for a job well done. It's no small feat to get paint on minis, and you all should feel really proud. Nothing gets the hobby juices flowing like finishing a project, and we all thank you for sharing your work, motivating us and the hobby community to paint our plastic. Thanks for sharing.